Hi, everybody. Michelangelo Badio. It is nice to see everyone here. I think we have a little latency. Something's going on. Oh, okay. Everything good? Anyway, it is nice to be back in my studio. I was in L.A. the last couple weeks. I love it out in California. It's great. The weather's beautiful. Here, it's nice and cold. And what does that mean? Dry air, so you look cool. But no, it's, you know, people ask me, well, how did you get so good on guitar? Because it was 75 below zero in the wintertime. You could die if you went outside. So what are you going to do? So I would just sit and go. Hey, Denny, how are you? Let's see who else is here. Cynthia, hi, how are you? Before we get started into what I wanted to talk about, which is I talk about a lot of stuff, Manowar, you know, as all of you know, I am the permanent guitarist in Manowar, and there's such a great buzz on the band. We did two big tours this year, and I mean, Manowar's an arena band, and one of the things that I love about being in this band, well, first of all, being in a band with Joey DeMaio and then Eric Adams. I mean, so you have this iconic singer who just, when you listen to his voice, it's incredible, and he's still incredible. And then Joey's just this visionary, and he's the real deal. They're both the real deal, and they've known each other since they were kids. But, you know, I've been in music a long time, too, and I've had my own very successful career outside, you know, just as a solo artist. But being part of the Manowar family is really incredible. And a couple of things I wanted to say. One, we're doing a USA show, and I know people say, well, why don't you do this, 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 and this? This show in New York that's coming up, tickets, we just put the tickets on sale yesterday. They're this close to being sold out. If you want to get a ticket, get it soon. They are going to be gone. Because here's the difference between one of them, between Manowar and many other bands. Well, first of all, they're one of the originators, just kind of like I'm one of the people that came up in the early days of Shred. I mean, the sign of the hammer. How many bands just have a sign? And when they talk about Warriors of the World United, that's one of the Manowar songs. They mean it. When we play in concert, there are flags from everywhere. It's we are united as one. And it's not political. It's not religious. It's like self-empowerment. You know, I mean, you know, sign of the hammer. But this show in New York is going to be the arena show. We're bringing the eagle. And another thing that I really like about Joey, he cares about how the audience listens. If you know anything about the band, you know that Jeff Hare, our sound man, has been with the band for many, many years, decades. And the sound and the quality and the crushing volume, it's all real, it's all there, and we don't want people sitting high in the balcony so they can't hear it and can't see it. Joey's very aware of that. So what we do is each show is an event. This is more than a concert. It's an event. And it's an event like, you know, this is a strange analogy, but when you know, I was not a huge Grateful Dead fan. It's not that I didn't like them, but, you know, the style of music, I was a metal guy. But the idea of Grateful Dead where the Deadheads would travel from city to city, country to country, go to different shows. Manowar has something similar to that. And again, not the genre. Not, it has nothing to do with band versus band. It's the idea that fans come from all over the world to come and see the shows. And that's because, and Joey is the visionary here, the shows are magnificent. They're mega. They're huge. Everything is mega. And so that's what I really love about it. So we don't have many tickets left. It's almost sold out. It's very, very close. But if you want to get tickets to see Manowar in the United States, this is the show. It's coming up in New York. And I can't stress it enough. You are seeing the full arena show at a beautiful theater. Granted, it's a big theater, but we're bringing the entire show because the stage, the height of the venue can accommodate the eagle, which is massive. So anyway, I just wanted to preface that. And then in a couple weeks, I'm going to be going to New York to record with Manowar. We're doing two albums next year. We're redoing Sign of the Hammer, which I love. I love that album, like Thor and Oh Man, Play On 10. That album's great. Or Guyana. Just these songs are magnificent. And so I talked to Dave earlier today, our drummer, and he showed me a picture of the kit being, you know, that's all set up and mic'd. It's just awesome. So we're releasing that, and we have a new album that's going to be coming out, too, of all brand new songs. And one of the songs that you heard, the very first one... So it was Immortal, and that was the first song that I played on in the studio, and that's kind of what got things going for me to be a member of the band. But I love being in the band, and I love the idea that every show is just, it's huge. That's all I can say. Multiple semis, seven semis of death. I mean, this show is, when you go backstage at a Manowar show, and I am not kidding when I say this, it looks like NASA. You see computers everywhere, and then I am playing through a rig of 7,000 watts. 70 Marshall heads of death! I'm not kidding when I say this. This is the loudest, it is, we call it war volume, and it is so insanely loud. But that's Manowar. We don't have in-ear monitors. We have PA system on the side. So I can go, yes, I'd like a little more hi-hat, please, so I can hear Dave play, because hat is the timepiece of most drummers. But this is a huge show, and that's the show that's going to be in New York, and I'm very happy to be a part of it. Okay, anyway, I saw you block somebody, Adam. So, okay, anyway... So now I want to talk a little bit, well, a lot about, I was just in L.A. with Sawtooth. As all of you know, I'm a Sawtooth endorsee. I love Sawtooth guitars. I am playing the Mini Jungle. They got a huge shipment of acoustic guitars in. You can see there is that's the Maple Jumbo. This is the Parlor guitar. This is a very, very cool guitar. This is the Mini Jumbo, and then here we have the Maple 12 string. These guitars sound great, and I'm going to tell you something, especially about the Mini Jumbo. This is absolutely the best sounding acoustic and most shred acoustic guitar I've ever played. And I don't mean that this is the best sounding acoustic for every application. Like, that has more low end. So does this than this, but these come with high-end Fishman pickup systems. The way the neck is, it joins at the 15th fret. See, the Parlor joins at the 12th. Look at the other, the big jumbos. They join at the 15th fret. You have this Mini Jumbo that is shred miser. Love this guitar. I truly love it. And because when I sit and practice this, I almost feel like it's an electric guitar. Sorry, I'm reading and let's see. Somebody wrote they're really drunk right now. Well, it's a holiday season. Joey wants to drink, too. I'm left-handed, but I'm a Gemini, so I would have two drinks. But all I can say is this. If there was any time to get a Sawtooth guitar, acoustic guitar, the time is now. We also have a lot of really cool new models coming out next year. For example... If you are familiar with the Primal Red, where we took this relic process and the essence of the guitar is red-ish. And then we have this roasted maple neck, Canadian maple. It's just beautiful. Well, we're doing a blue version. So it's going to be the Primal Blue of Death. And it's just a beautiful guitar. And so that's coming out. And see, somebody asked, when's my birthday? June 12th. I am a true Gemini, sign of the twins. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And we also, we just redesigned the double guitar. You're going to see this. It is the most rad, cool metal shape ever. You know, I wanted to do something different when we released the kind of Telecaster shape, the Tele shape of the double. And that's, you know, everything that I never did on a double guitar. But the irony is, it's the only company, and I'm not a company hopper. You know that, you know, people that know me know I don't jump from company to company to company. I'm a loyal person. Even the last company I was with, the owner passed away. But I had a great relationship with Joe and Kevin, and especially Joe, the owner of, you know, those are the two main owners of Sawtooth. But I had a really good relationship with them, and especially Joe, before I'd actually signed with Sawtooth. And, you know, it was a very natural progression. But one of the things that I can say unequivocally is that Sawtooth has been the only company out of three major companies I've been with in my life that was able to mass produce a guitar. And then when you count Wayne Charvel in the 80s, when I was with Wayne Charvel, the man Charvel, the guy whose name is on the Charvel guitars, he had his own company. He went with Gibson guitars. Then he was with BC Rich first. Then he went to Gibson. Then he started his own company, Ritz. And I told Wayne, I love him to death. I said, Wayne, I can't just keep jumping from company to company. I said, that ruins all credibility for me. I said, I'm with you, but you keep moving around. And even back then, even those companies, I have a great Gibson double. I had a BC Rich double. That one's actually gone. But none of these companies were able to do a production model like Sawtooth. And then all of a sudden, you know, this is something that's interesting to me. And I was talking about it with Joey from Manowar. That, you know, you get these people, you know, we put out this limited edition double guitar. Well, that I invented that guitar. That's my signature trademark. And all of a sudden, you know, people are coming out playing the guitar. And I like the guy that do. And I didn't expect that. He didn't, you know, nobody, I didn't know he bought one. I don't know his real name. I've never met him. And I thought, too, that, you know, they're not trying to play, make a tribute to me. They're trying to really do it, which I think is great. Because it's like it inspired me to say, you know what? These guys are like when Rob Scallon came to my studio, standing right here, and he's playing one side with a clean sound. It was so cool and different, and it was inspiring to me to see these people trying to, you know, not just, you know, obviously, you know, they pay tribute in the way that they say I am the inventor, but they're trying to do, and they are doing things that are new and different, and I think it's really great. Let's see. Somebody asked me if I'm going to NAMM in January. The answer is no. You know, I don't like to miss NAMM. And someone asked if I ever met Eddie Van Halen. I did. And I got to talk to him one-on-one for over a half an hour. I know his son, Wolf. And that's a great story. Just the Eddie Van Halen story alone is great. Because he watched me play guitar and said I was really great. And we got literally to talk. I was 3 feet away, 1 meter, you know, 39 inches, whatever. I was a little over 1 meter away from him. And we talked at a show in Chicago for well over half an hour, just me and him. And but anyway, getting back to NAMM, here's the thing about NAMM. Where is Steve Vai doing his Vai Academy this year in January? He lives in California. Where's he doing it? In Florida. In Orlando, okay? I just watched an advert today from Jordan Rudess. What's going on right now is there are still things in place in NAMM. They really, how can I say this? I love NAMM, and I've been to NAMM since I was a 21-year-old guy going to college, auditioning to be a NAMM demo guy for Morley Effects Pedals, which I did get the job. I was the last guy to audition, but I got it. And so I never missed a NAMM in the 21st century until COVID. But I think NAMM has to understand and redefine what they want to do, because it is super, super expensive to be at a NAMM show. Dean Guitars, the company when I was with before the owner died, it's been close to $1 million on a booth, for real. and Gibson and Yamaha and Roland, they would spend millions and millions. And you know, the traffic. So what we can do in a live stream right now is reach thousands and thousands of people. And what does it cost? You know, Adam is here. You know, he's our the video guy, a great friend of mine. And what does it cost to do this? And so I think NAMM, as much as I love it, they have to, you know, a lot of big companies are not going. So they've got to figure this one out. And I want to see it survive. But I'm not the owner. I'm not the owner of NAMM. I'm not the CEO of NAMM. But they better start really thinking about what they're doing to keep the people coming there. Okay, let's see. Anaheim is so insane cost-wise. Somebody wrote that. Yeah. But, you know, somebody, do you remember music theory class as a kid in the early days? Yes, I do. I have a great story about music theory. Here it is. I'm in high school. Now, when I'm going to say a little bit about my family here. My dad was a builder. And he's been gone, you know, a long, long time. And my mom, you know, it's a weird Christmas for me now because, you know, my younger sister passed away. All my immediate family is gone. So, you know, I love Christmas. I'm going to be with my brother-in-law, my nephew, my cousin, and my cousin's son, another cousin who's a big-time video director. He actually did the videography for the last Rolling Stones video, Harry Styles, Paul McCartney. So we're going to all hang out. So my nephew has both sides of the family successful in music and entertainment. It's pretty wild. We're both like, yeah, I played 15,000 people here. Well, yeah, I just did the new Harry Styles and Rolling Stones video. Literally the last Rolling Stones video my cousin did. And so it's interesting. But, you know, when you somebody wrote NAMM dinosaurs. Oh, come on. But, you know, getting I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought. Adam, what was that question?
Music theory.
I'm sorry. You know, I'm thinking about my family. I'm thinking my dad's not here, my mom's not here, my sister's not here. Gah! But you know why I say da? Because it's Russian for yes. So I never really say no. But anyway, the music theory class. When I was a kid, I started guitar 10. I started with a teacher named Roger Grimm, and he showed me four chords. He showed me G major, only four strings. Then he showed me D7. Then he showed me C. Then he showed me G7. So I heard these four chords, and I'm 10 years old. I'm like, those sound weird. My first lesson, you know what I took those four chords and I did? Literally, I remember this to my dying day. I organized them into a musical phrase. I organized them so it made sonic sense to me. Instead of just hearing these random chords, I went. I literally did that. My teacher was like, well, how did you figure that out? I go, I don't know. It just sounded right. And you know, I feel like, you know, in Dune, it just seemed the proper way. And so, but what happened was this. When I started to learn more chords, I didn't even know bar chords. It was when I was in fifth grade. I was in 10 years old. We were 10 years old when I first started playing. I got into this band, and it turned out the guitarist in the band ended up being my seventh grade art teacher. But we were doing a song like... by the Monkees. That was the first lead I ever learned. And you know what I did? I went. I played that lead. I'll never figure out. It just seemed cool. I don't even know how I came up with that. I didn't know it was a pentatonic. I was a kid. I was 10. And I went. Like. But if you hear the original Valerie by the Monkees, wait till you hear the guitar. I think it was Chet Atkins playing, but it was a lot of legato, but it was just beautiful, really fast guitar. And so what happened with music theory is this. I was so involved in guitar. I knew at 10 years old, and I've said this before, but this is the truth. You know, I'm a lot of things, but I'm not a liar. I don't lie, ever. Because if you lie, it always comes back to haunt you. It'll, you know, and if you lie to yourself, it's even worse. But and there's no reason to lie. The truth is the truth. You never have to remember the truth. It's how people get caught in crimes. Police will ask them 50,000 times, well, what happened? And sooner or later, they forget the lie that they told. But you don't have to forget the truth. The truth is the truth. But here's what I know. When I was when I was 10, I told myself, I'm going to be a professional guitarist and I'm going to tour the world. That is what I'm going to do. This is going to be my life. Now, when I was a sophomore in high school, I joined the jazz band because when I was 10, I had Roger showing me this stuff, but then he quit. And then I had this guy named Arnie Evanson, and Arnie was great. All of a sudden, he starts going like this. Starts teaching me jazz chords, and one of the first songs I learned, I talked about this, Stormy. Chords like E minor 9, A13th, how about this one? A minor 11th, which is, and I used to love 11th chords. And I learned also slash chords, like, you know, the perfect example is the old stick song. So you would see C, then you would see F slash C. C/C, or like you get the Steely Dan chord. If I want a sound fusion, there he is. There he is. Somebody wrote, a Gemini that doesn't lie. That's stupid. Sorry. What does it mean? It means the sign of the twins. You know what it means for me? I'm an artist and a business person. Oh, yeah. And so, the business side of me makes good decisions, and the artist lets, the business side lets the artist do it. So anyway, but also, too, I'm also very positive. You might laugh when I say this, but I'll go, da! I say da. Da in Russian is yes. And you have to, in my world, I have to be around positive people. If I hear negativity, even on my page, I'm really weird about this because if you are who you hang out with, you know, in Nitro, what do we say? And you've heard me say this, but it's kind of a recap of the world according to Mikey. Jim Gillette said this. Now, I'm not saying he invented this, but this is Jim and I. Jim said, you can't soar with the eagles if you hang out with turkeys. Now, a lot of things are written about eagles and motivation, but here's a great analogy of an eagle. When there's a storm and it's raining and it's thundering, the eagles can fly so high they can fly above the clouds of the storm. That is an eagle. That is what you do. I have a low tolerance for excuses. I have a low tolerance for people who say, I can't do this, man. I tried. Well, how about in The Empire Strikes Back when Luke tried to raise the ship when he was at Yoda's? And he's like, and the ship starts to bubble. And you hear, duh, you hear. Wait, no. So you hear this, and the ship is bubbling. And Luke, it falls in the water. And then Yoda, who's like a meter tall, goes, I'll show you a little punk. And all of a sudden, you see him, and he does a, you know, he's like, does a sniffle. And like, you hear the music, and the ship rises out of the bog, the swamp. And goes like this. And then And then and then Luke looks at Yoda and he goes, "Master, I tried." What did Yoda say? "That is why you failed. Try. Uh-uh. Do or do not." So anyway, that's all I can say. Does he teach basic? Does anyone know? I don't know. Somebody wrote beagles can't fly with the eagles.
I'd hate to see one dropped out of a helicopter or an airplane.
But, you know, the only thing you would see is it's flopping into the ground are these big ears. You know, and hopefully it could be like Snoopy, maybe like a propeller or something. But anyway, getting back to music there, I'm just off on a tangent because I'm having a good time. It's the holidays and everything's going great. Manowar is killing and Sawtooth is killing and everything's great. But when I was a sophomore, here's what I did. Here I had learned all these jazz chords from Marty Evanson. You know, major sevens, you know, minor sevens, 13, 13 flatted 9, augmented 11. And then we did this, check this augmented 11. And it's not an easy chord to play. You know what I learned? You know what? Like. You know, all this crazy stuff. And so, and here I'm a kid, you know, I'm 11, 12 years old, and learning all this, you know, and then what I did is on Stormy. Arnie said, try to write a guitar solo, because I didn't really understand modes, but he gave me like a basic. He went, and I heard him play, and I was listening. See, one of the things that I had as a kid, I had a really good ear. Like, I remember listening to the radio, and I could figure out, I could hear the progressions. That's when I knew, like, I would hear, you know. In fact, one of the bands that blew my mind that I couldn't understand at first was the Beatles. And then the second band that blew my mind was Queen. When I heard Killer, Queen, Gunpowder, Chill, I was like, what are these chords? I couldn't actually understand in my head. I couldn't wrap my head around the chord progressions. But like, you know, when I would hear AC/DC, you know, I love AC/DC to the max. Just because something's simple doesn't mean it's not really good. But, you know, Stairway to Heaven, you know, I heard all that stuff right away. You know, that. You know, I heard it right away. But I couldn't understand, when I didn't understand things, it was just, you know, harmonically, or like Elton John would hear, "Goodbye, Yellow Brick Road." You know, these chord progressions are not stock and they're not standard. And so, you know, it took me a little while to understand that. It wasn't until I was in the university level that I really made it, that it made sense to me. But here's what happened. So I'm a sophomore in high school. I learned all these jazz chords. I auditioned for the jazz band in my high school. And this guy, the head of the music department, O.D. Primo, Othello de la Primo. And I remember it like it was yesterday. We were a new school. If you've ever seen The Breakfast Club, that is my high school. Believe it or not, they filmed The Breakfast Club at my high school. It was called Maine North. Now, it closed down many years ago. Some genius built a brand new high school in my area, but they forgot to take a census. And so they built this gigantic school. We only had like 2,000 kids that went there. Might sound like a lot, but there was Maine North, Maine East, Maine West, Maine South. The other three schools had over 3,500 students per school. So they built, I should have gone to Maine East. And so, but no, I had to go to Maine North, this brand new school. We had a very, you know, it was, I think we were the first graduating class for sure, but I think the maximum amount was like 1,800 students or 2,000. So let's say it's 2,000, and because I don't know exactly, but I know it's no more than 2,000. I auditioned for the jazz band, and when I was growing up, everybody played an instrument. I mean, it didn't matter. Music was so popular. Instruments were so popular, kind of like today too. You know how many guitarists showed up for that? One, me. Now, here's the wild thing about music theory. the guy, the Othello de la Primo, Mr. Primo, the head of the music department, was in charge of directing the jazz band. He hands me this music. And I knew jazz chords, that I knew a lot of different chords, different, you know, I knew a C major, something could be played here, 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 here. You know, I knew a lot of different variations and inversions. And I'm looking at this chord chart. I didn't know how to play anything. I'm like, I go, Mr. Primo, you know, but it's like, Mr. Primo, I don't really, I can't do it. He goes, okay, you're in. And I said, but I'll figure it out. And he said, I'm in. You know why? No one else auditioned. In my entire school, no one auditioned but me. So then what I did is I went to the music store where I did take lessons, because here's something I didn't tell you. After Arnie Evanson, I took lessons from a teacher named Frank Dawson. I remember this like it's yesterday. Frank told me when I was 13, he couldn't teach me anymore. He said, he goes, you're faster at 13 years old than I was at 22. And by that time, he's probably in his 25, his late 20s. He goes, I don't know what to teach you anymore. He goes, you know the chords. He goes, you're ripping. He goes, and basically I was on my own. So I took lessons for 3 years, 2 + 2 = 4 - 1. And then I was on my own. But I was a student of music, and I always loved it. So what I did was, when I got these charts, because here's what I was seeing from the jazz band. C, triangle 7. C, circle. Like, what the heck is a circle? C minus? What are we, in math? You know, a C plus. And I'm like, what the heck is going on? So I went to the music store where I took lessons from Roger Grimm, from Mr. Grimm, from Arnie Evanson, and from Frank Dawson. And one of the guys behind the counter, his name is Pat something. I never took lessons from him, but he was a really nice guy. And you know, I couldn't drive, so my mom drove me there. And I go, what is this? And he starts laughing. He goes, C triangle means C major. It's a C major seventh. I go, what? Because see, Arnie had written down in Frank, C M A J 7. I'm like, oh, okay. And so I said, what is the minus? Is it minor? He goes, yes. So you see C minus 7. What is the circle? Diminished. What is the plus? Augmented. All of a sudden, instead of seeing C A U G, I saw C plus. C D I M for diminished. I saw a circle. So all of a sudden, I'm like, whoa, dude! It's like, rah, not like tasty buns and good brews, dude. Oh, yeah, dude. I'm like, I've got it. And so all of a sudden, I'm like, I figured it out. I'm like, well, I didn't figure it out. I had help. I'm never one to be afraid to ask. That's something in life. I'm not kidding. I'll ask. I have no shame in asking somebody if I need help with something. I never have, I never will, and it's always served me well. And because it takes a lot of the guesswork out. But when he told me that, the whole thing opened up. And I remember I won a jazz award as a sophomore for playing a solo. We did this, these Stan Kenton charts. And Stan Kenton just wrote great jazz charts. And in fact, when I tried to get them to play Frank Zappa's Peaches and Regalia, and Mr. Primo looked at it and he goes, no. I'm like, but it's a good song! And he wouldn't do it. He's like, this is just way outside what this band is, it can do. And I really loved being in the jazz band. But here's the point. I knew nothing about music theory yet. I just knew chords, and my ear would guide me. And I realized, you know, over the years, people like an Yngwie Malmsteen, or even, there's no way he has a degree in music, but his ear is so good that it takes him where he wants to go. And what I learned about music theory later in life is that it's only a reason that things sound great. Why do you think that computers can do music so well? Because it's mathematics. You have 0 to 127, which is a MIDI volume. It goes up to 127. So you can use volume as far as expression, and you can decrease and increase tempos. So you can add expression in the digital world. And so if I just go, that's all able to be written mathematically. What's not able to do that, what you can't do is write Jimi Hendrix going, wah, blah, 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 whoa, 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 or a Dimebag song. But we have the recordings. So when I was a junior in high school, I was able to take music theory for the first year. And I remember, I was real popular in school because I always, and I looked like a radical. See, when I was a freshman year, we had a dress code. You couldn't grow your hair long. It literally was a dress code. But sophomore year, they stopped it. And so I was able to start growing my hair long. By junior year, I looked like, and then my family was in the U.S. military from World War II on. I had all these like ROTC jackets. I had all this military stuff, and it looked cool. So my hair was real long, and I'd go to school in these like ROTC jackets, ROTC, and the funny thing was it smelled like it was made in 1940. I mean, I actually had a spray with deodorant. I never wash it, but I would go to school like, yeah, I'm cool, man. You know, but don't get too close. You might smell the fragrance of rock. And so, but what happened was I go to music theory, and I'm starting to learn, and I'm starting to realize, and I started hating jazz chords. I started hating these chords. We used to call these undetermined. It was no third. So, because the thirds are the sonority, the thirds determine whether it's major, minor, whether it's an augmented, whether. So the third of the chord is our music theory, our style of our Western music is called tertian harmony, based on thirds. Okay, tertian means based on thirds. Okay, so when you hear this, you know it's major, minor, major, minor. Well, I like none of the above, undetermined. So you could just go. Okay, let's see. Okay, somebody wrote about the hydro. It's about to rub off on it. Okay, I don't know what that kind of meant. But anyway, yeah, somebody said, Steve, about the hydro. I love Steve Vai. What is the hydro? It looks really cool. It's a steampunk guitar. Okay, so I can take one neck and go. And then I can go to the next neck and go. Then I can go to the next neck and go. And then go. I think it's killer, but I don't see the need for that. I would rather do this. And the thing that I think for myself, just for myself, I want to produce instruments like we do with Sawtooth for you. And so I don't think the Hydra is something that, you know, a lot of people are going to play. It's gotten Steve Vai a lot of publicity because it looks killer, that steampunk look. Well, how many guitars have had three necks over the years? A lot. You know, Pat Metheny, you know. I mean, so multi-neck guitars are nothing new. It's more of a piece of artwork to me. And so, you know, like, try to play this, you know, and not go. Rob Scallon tried to play it, and he saw how difficult it was. And Rob's a good buddy. But, you know, he was like, whoa, this is not easy. You know, to go like, you know, like a. Da, 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 da. To me, that's harder. And you know, then. And so, but it doesn't mean that the Hydra is not amazing. But I think it's a visual thing because just the look of it, it's like a piece of artwork. You know, it's almost more to me like art than it is like something to play as an instrument because it's very cool. Okay, let's see. It's closer to major. Who's the guy in Cheap Trick? Rick Nielsen. Okay, anyway, I'm going to finish my music theory question in 45 minutes here because I keep looking at all the questions here. But I really appreciate, you know, the support that you've everyone has given me. I just got a YouTube award for having over 100,000 followers, and I never even tried to grow YouTube. That's the thing that makes it so special for me. You know, I didn't come up in this young generation of, you know, content-orientated deliveries of what you do. And so, you know, it's something that, you know, it's like Guthrie Govan, I think, said, you know, I didn't sign up for this one. And I just didn't sign up to be an influencer. And so to get, you know, have people just, you know, organically come to the page, I'm really, really happy. And thank you very much. Now, getting back to my story of music theory. Now, I'm a junior in high school. Now, I'm known in the school. I was in six V Show acts when I was a sophomore. Not only did I join the jazz band, we used to do plays. And so I joined a play called Fiddle Around the Roof. And it's like a... And I played mandolin. And they had these great melodies like... And then I also played things like Jesus Christ Superstar. Like, I don't know how to love you. Da da do da da do do. Yeah, I mean, it's just such beautiful music. I was involved in all this. I wanted to do as much as I could. I was in the I was even in like the band that played at basketball games. I wanted to do as much as humanly possible when I was a sophomore. So it got me known, and I look like a total radical. I've all, you know, people say, dress your age. I do! I dress like a rocker! And, you know, I'm not trying to be, yo, see what I'm saying, M-N-M. I could be M-A-B, yo. Why do you think Joey? J-O-E-E. Joey! Who do you want to be? Who do you want to see? Joey. And so... But what happened when I was a junior, I started to learn about music theory. That's why I said I started to hate jazz chords. I was in this metal vein. You know, I listened to like metal. I'm listening to Black Sabbath Volume 4. I'm listening to as heavy of music as I can find. King Crimson. I just wanted as heavy as possible. I was so under, even. And so what I did was I started going against all the jazz stuff. I was like, became this purist and elitist, like many people online are tonight. Arias, my tastes are so evolved. It's like I have transcended the norm, like my opinion is transcendent. And so, you know, and I became that like arrogant little kid, like, well, I don't like jazz chords, jazz suck. You know, I want metal. And so what happened was, I remember our teacher, and this was great. He was the head of the chorus. His job was to teach choir. And I was not in the choir. He asked me, so he comes in, and he's like, he knows I was this hotshot little guitar player. And he goes, okay, Mike, I want you to bring your guitar and amp, and you show us. And he starts asking me questions. And he goes, okay, I want you to play a minor ninth scale. Now, there's no such thing. I didn't know at the time. But I knew a ninth was 9 scale degrees. You know, it was a second. I knew that. And I didn't know. I didn't know it was a trick question. So I went like this. I went like this. And I went. And then he goes, okay, play it again. And I played the exact thing. And I stressed that nine. And he looks at me. And then I got mad because, you know, he's giving me like this sturdy look. And then I went. And then he goes, I played this really fast riff. And he goes, okay, diarrhea of the fingers, get out. And he kicked me out of the class, literally kicked me out. And I'm like, whoa. And so when I, you know, and I realized back then, I better learn a lot more. So that's the moral of my story. And all I can say is this, I have 1,000 stories about music. But one of the things that I do, I seek out knowledge. I'm always a student. And one of the things that I love to do, the Fiddler on the Roof, yeah, fascinating beginning. Somebody asked me a good question. I'm kind of talking and looking at questions here. I've got a big monitor. Somebody asked, were you always fast from the beginning? Yes, I just was. And like I used to, you know, I was really fast, especially being left-handed. My fretboard hand was really fast. And so, and then I learned alternate picking because I'm left-handed. This was my weak hand. But I can say this, you know, now I still love to practice. I practiced 3 hours last night. And with this guitar, it's the closest thing to an electric I have ever played. It's the Sawtooth Mini Jump. Sawtooth is a great company. They make fantastic guitars. Anyway, that's it. I'll be here next week right after Christmas. I'm Michelangelo Badio. See ya.